go straight to your place,
uh-huh.
and open the door, and then uh-huh. what you do is... So, uh-huh. no. Now listen, I slaved for a whole week while he sat there rereading the poetry of John Donne.
Mr. Wolf didn't call me, Archie. Fritz did, Miss Rowan.
Fritz?
You realize this is going to cost you.
Mr. Panzer, will you please see the irresistible Miss Rowan home?
Sure thing.
Archie, strike one.
There are three things everyone knows about Nero Wolfe. One, he is a genius. Two, he raises orchids. And three, he never leaves the house on business.
Fritz! Now remember something when you tell me why I came here. I just gave up breakfast with a delectable woman who has a cook almost as artful as you.
Archie.
What?
Please. First, Theodore just disappears.
What?
One must tend one's mother if one is sick. I understand that. But to have him worrying himself sick about his orchids, working from 8 in the morning until 8 at night. Last night, the Meltonia ceilings were bitten by cold.
Well, admittedly, that is tragic.
So, he has decided that he must sleep up there.
Clearly, if I can find no one to replace Theodore, I'll do it. I'll do it. These are the sheets. Fritz gave you these. Clearly, if I can find no one to replace Theodore, this is the only alternative.
You won't accept anyone less than Andrew Krasicki,
No, we don't know if Theodore is going to be away for 6 days, or 6 months, or 6 years. Yes. Clearly, I have to find someone I can trust. I have to find a man who knows what...
It's no dice. Andrew Krasicki works for Joseph Pitcairn. You wrote him a letter, he didn't answer you.
Well, letters go astray.
You found and you got brushed off.
By a butler. He has not actually spoken to me.
Well, I know why you're so fixated on this, and that's because Lewis Hewitt recommended him. Right? And you don't like me using it, but I use other
people's... Get the car!
The car?
Yes, if Krasicki will not come to us, we will go to Krasicki!
Now?
Yes!
And so it was that early on a wet December morning, grim and resolute, ready to do or die, Nero Wolfe went out.
Is there something wrong with the car? Perhaps there's something wrong with the car.
I drove him north into the raging wilds of Westchester. Stanley making for Livingston in Africa was nothing compared to Wolf making for Krasicki in Westchester.
Keep your eyes on the road!
When we reached Pitcairn's estate, we drove around back by the service road. For as Wolf said, far from coming to visit the owner, we had come to steal something from him.
Come on, let's go while we're young. He's just like Ray Bulger.
Let me know.
Yeah.
Are you Mr. Andrew Krasicki?
My God, you're Nero Wolfe. Oh, my God. You're Nero Wolfe, aren't you?
I confess it. May I speak with you?
Well, yes, of course.
I wrote you a letter, but I got no reply.
Well, yes, it's all settled. Everything's fine. I just wrote you a letter back myself. I can come whenever you say, Mr. Wolfe.
I want to sit down.
Well, you're more than welcome to come inside. If you like, but I'm just on my way to the greenhouse. I'm always late after a fumigation.
Oh, yes, of course. Are there any decent stools there?
Stools, sir? Yeah. Yes, of course. Yes.
Wolf's reaction was perfectly natural. He had just gotten wonderful news. But he had also learned that if he had stayed home, he would have gotten it in the morning's mail. That was hard to take standing up.
You owe me a dime, boss.
How you figure?
Well, it didn't snow.
See my lawyer.
This is Barry.
It's a cheerful welcome.
Yeah, it's kind of poetic. Of course, that was here when I got here. It was Mrs. Pitcairn herself that painted it. Okay, there we go.
Cyanogas G.
Cyphogen.
And it just is deadly.
Well, it's quite all right. We've had the vents open for a couple of hours. Feel free to.
This is yours?
It's Mr. Pitcairn's.
I don't care who owns it. Who grew it?
Oh, that was me. No, I right from a seat, I grew this one. Done really well.
Mr. Kosicki, I would like to shake your hand.
Thank you, Mr. Wolf. Thank you. I assume now that you'll be wanting me to sleep at your house, am I right?
Of course, how else?
Well, there's something of a problem there. You see, recently there's been a change. I've become engaged to Mrs. Pitcairn's nurse. Mrs. Pitcairn, I don't know if you're aware, but... She broke her back.
I see.
Wolf's reaction was admirably subdued. The possibility of a woman in the house for any length of time was, of course, intolerable. But reason and desperation prevailed.
Well, of course, this will not be forever. Theodore will return.
Oh, Theodore.
And we will find you and your new bride a new place.
Oh, thank you very much, Mr. Wolf. Listen, I have something else I'd like to show you. I don't know if you have time.
Of course.
It's a curiosity. Of course, you're familiar with the Tibicina semidecanter, of course.
Yes, I am.
Well, I have this plant that I've had for 2 years. I raised this one only from a cutting. Well, you'll never guess what happened. It sported a branch.
No.
I just got it in here, out of hiding and resting under the light.
Are you all right? You hit your head. Are you all right?
There's a dead woman in here.
She's dead?
Dead and cooled off.
She's dead.
Cyphogen poisoning?
Confound it!
It's one hell of a note. If Nero Wolf can't go to Westchester to lasso an orchid tender without a corpse butting in to gum up the works.
Your plant is mutilated. The branch that sported, it's broken.
I'll say to it, sir.
Did you kill her?
Did I what?
Easy. Don't like the question? You're going to be answering it all day. You might as well tell us. Did you kill her?
No. God, no.
Who is she?
It was just right in here last night. I asked her to marry me, and now here I am standing here. What am I going to do?
Well, you were supposed to come and work for me tomorrow.
What am I going
to do? Now what? Is there a phone in the cottage?
Yeah, I saw a line coming in outside.
Andrew!
Sir?
Come here. Come.
I'm terribly sorry, sir.
Don't be sorry. Just come with me. We'll talk before we go on the phone. Archie, stay with her.
You're never really alone in a greenhouse. It was a cinch. Deanie Lauer was rolled under that canvas after sundown. From her face, she had been alive when that happened. What made her obligingly lie there and wait for the gas to work? Whoever that was annoyed, and I didn't want him to find Andy before Wolf had finished with him.
Who the hell are you? Neil!
Joseph Pitcairn, I presume.
Is Miss Lauer in there?
Well, you make it an even dozen, I'll answer.
Dozen? Dozen what?
Questions, or I'll trade you. Ever heard of Nero Wolf?
Quit stalling. Something's happening, I'm going in there.
Oh, yeah, easy,
watch
sister.
Watch your city, I bet that's actually a good one. Just as soon hit a woman.
Put your tail between your legs and be quiet. How dare you barricade my door.
I admit I'm not acting normal, but then again, upon seeing a stranger in your house, your first question is Miss Lauer in there? Why is that?
Easy.
Jake!
State police, open up.
Evidently, Wolf's talk with Andy had been short and sour, since he did something he never resorts to if he can help it.
Lieutenant Noonan, state police.
Calling the cops.
Well, Archie Goodfin.
Lieutenant Con Noonan of the state police had been a stinker from the start. He and Detective Ben Dykes refused to accept me as a human until right. Cleveland Archer, the DA, arrived.
The general agreement. That Andy Krasicki was jelly for Deanie Lauer.
He saw her and he was drowned. He didn't even float. He just lay there on the bottom.
And the last time anyone sees Miss Lauer, it's 9 o'clock. And she's on her way to meet Mr. Krasicki in the greenhouse with some beer. We got enough.
Well, given the means, it would appear to be so.
How can you conclude that, sir? Why would Andy Krasicki kill Miss Lauer on the very day she agreed to marry him?
Married?
Well, Dinny was going to marry him? Pah!
You share any of this happy news with anybody? Anybody but these two?
Good Lord, I hope not.
I was in no mood to assess Wolf's professionalism. All I wanted was to get my thumbs in a proper position behind Noonan's ears and bear down.
Mr. Wolf, professional law enforcement, we would call that convenient. And if it was me, you'd be looking for bail as a material witness.
Huh. Remember we was wondering how he got her to lie down so nicely and wait while he turns on the poison? M.E. says he put morphine in her beer.
Did he get it from Mrs. Embry?
Sybil!
Oh, please, Daddy. We all know about Mrs. Embry's problem and her cure.
And?
It's for a neuralgia.
I haven't had to use them for a month. Is this going to be over soon?
In a minute.
There is a box of morphine pellets in the cupboard in the kitchen. We all know about them. Well, come on!
Well, that gave the law a good excuse to search the whole house and Andy's cottage. No morphine pellets were found. Meanwhile, Wolf and I beat it to the greenhouse to discuss what Wolf had learned from Andy.
Andy had a tete-a-tete with her late that afternoon. There, at last she surrendered, agreed to marry him.
Since he wished to accept my offer, he asked her to leave her position with the Pitcairns and get one in New York. She asked him to keep their agreement private until she had broken the news to Mrs. Pitcairn.
They met again later that evening at around 9 o'clock. Drank beer, talked. She left at 11 via the door to the living room, and that was the last he ever saw of her.
At 2 o'clock, he and Gus taped all the windows and doors. After the rooms were all locked off, he sent Gus out and...
He opens up the Cypogen master valve for 8 minutes. And then he closes it again. He locks the door, puts up the sign door to death. And then at dawn he returns and he opens up the vents and he goes back to bed.
We can assume that the murderer had 3 hours to place the body into position. What about the others?
Well, they all got peachy alibis, see? They were all asleep.
No, I don't care what happens to me. Just get the bastard that did this.
Yes, it is my hope that you will stay at my house tonight.
If it was up to me, Wolf, you'd be looking for bail for yourself as a material witness.
Didn't you say that before? What's wrong?
Hey, you want, I could say it again.
Wait, Archer! The charges against Andrew Krasicki can be anything short of first-degree murder. The bail can be any amount of money. I shall pay it. But please, let me keep him. In the end, you will thank me when I've got the facts and you've got to take them.
Why don't you just get a gardener who's not a killer?
What can the charge be but first-degree murder, Mr. Wolf?
There is one point that proves his innocence, absolutely. You of the law assume... And so do I, Nero Wolf, that the flower pot underneath the bench was overturned when the body was rolled underneath.
Yeah, so?
It is inconceivable that Andrew Krasicki could have left it that way. He would have most certainly righted it and retrieved the precious branch.
Is this before or after he kills her?
For a plant man such as Andrew Kosicki, this would have been automatic. Indeed, I myself witnessed him save this precious branch while still reeling from the insanity of just having seen the dead body.
I've heard tell of your fantasies, Wolf, but if this is a sample, I'll take strawberry. If it was me, you'd be looking for bail as a material witness.
I can't believe you. You said it again. You just said it again.
Listen.
Later. What about motive? You gonna argue with a straight face? Did he fumigate her to death because he couldn't have her? A little grade A jealousy wouldn't hurt. Was there a love triangle?
Well, let's not speculate too far.
Well, what about somebody else? I mean, Neil Imbrie doesn't look the part. Gus Trouble doesn't act the part. But then there's the Pitcairns, the father and the son. But I don't think they're the kind of people, servant of the people, would take a poke at. But I don't know. You never know.
They've been questioned, Mr. Goodwin, thoroughly. We've done our job thoroughly, and we have our suspect.
Well, as pleasant as this is, I'd like to get back to New York before Christmas. Oh, I forgot to tell you, I'm getting married. Caterer has been called, the flowers have been sent, the people have been invited.
Shut up, I'm trying to think. This chair.
The chair? What?
Were you waiting for someone?
Oh, yes, yes.
Yes?
Who? Who? Yes. Anyone. Anyone. You. Anyone.
He's eccentric, Daddy. He's being eccentric.
Be quiet, Sybil. Lieutenant Noonan left the man at the entrance to my grounds to keep people from entering. The man has orders not to prevent anyone's departure. Now that this miserable and sordid episode is finished. Your presence. No,
it is not finished. And that Lieutenant Noonan is an ass for allowing you lunatic farm animal people to be traipsing around, wandering to and fro, free to go as you please, when one of you is most certainly a Mera. Why is your daughter hysterical? Why are you hysterical?
Oh, that was so corny, Nero.
Are you addressing me?
I'm disappointed in you. I thought you were better than that.
Now I am resolved. You have resolved me. I have been engaged to clear Mr. Krasicki's name, and I intend to do it. May I remain here until I am either satisfied that he is guilty or am equipped to satisfy others that he is not.
That was much better, that role.
I've had enough of this.
Where'd you get that? Museum?
Very well. I shall manage on my own. This is the key to Mr. Krasicki's cottage, which he gave me in order for me to collect his belongings. We are going there now to do so. Any comment?
No.
Good.
Morphine? No. DUP, period. GRNHS, period. Duplicate greenhouse.
Oh, brilliant.
I want to make it plain that I don't like the way you're acting. Huh. You know, many times in the past, you've sat behind your desk and said, Archie, go get who's it's and what's it's. That I've delivered. But if you plan on having me drive you back to New York and then upon arrival say, go get the Pitcairns or the Imbries or Gus Treble or...
There's the phone. Call Fritz.
I won't even bother listening to you. Not the way you've bungled things up here. All because a pretty girl called you by your first name.
She isn't pretty. Not pretty.
She was pretty. Fritz.
Yes, Fritz. We've been delayed.
Now, I'm no woodsman, but it didn't seem reasonable that wind could make a leafless branch perform like that.
No. No, not on the north wall. No! Not a one! Idiot! Confound you!
Fun if I knew what it was for.
You're a double-crossing son of a bitch.
That's still vague. Who'd we double-cross?
You make him think that you're with him, and then you get him framed.
Oh, brother, you know what you are? You're the answer to a prayer. You're what we wanted for Christmas. I want you to come inside and tell Nero Wolfe he's a double-crossing liar. Come on.
Thus, I came here. I left my home. With one purpose in mind, and that is to acquire a true orchid man. A man of Andy Krasicki's caliber. Now I ask you, can I have him in my plant rooms and in Sing Sing simultaneously?
No. But...
I am asking you because you are a real orchid man, you understand? You know, Andy has told me that you are exceptionally talented.
He did?
And consider this, this Lieutenant Noonan, this man who arrested him. He is a man who uses the law to trample on the innocent.
Noonan beat up a friend of mine last year. For nothing.
For nothing, exactly, for nothing. A typical uniform blackguard. Gus helped me prove him wrong.
Okay. All right. Anything. What do you want?
All right, first, Miss Lauer. I gather that you were not attracted by her.
Me? Nah, not that baby. She was out for a sucker. If I'd have known Andy had popped the question, I might have fumigated her myself, just as a favor.
That would have been an adequate motive for a friend. Was she after money?
Worse. She got her kick seeing males react. Females, too. Neil Imbrie, old enough to be her father, and her giving him the idea while his wife was watching.
What about when his wife was not watching? Could Neil Imbrie have found heaven with Miss Lauer? And if he did, and if Miss Lauer taunted him by saying that she was going to marry Andy, and if Andy then...
Yeah, a lot of ifs. He could have that in him, sure. If she hooked him deep enough.
Well, his motive we can assume. Miss Imbrie's is implicit. Of course, women don't require motives that are comprehensible by intellectual processes, do they?
You said it, man. They roll their own.
What about Miss Pitcairn?
I feel like I hate her, but I don't really know why. I guess it's because she says right out she hates men, so I hate her, just to even it up.
Well, I need a scandalous fact about her. I mean, the worse the better. Is she a kleptomaniac? Is she a seducer of other women's husbands? A drug addict?
She fights a lot.
She fights a lot.
Especially with her brother. She always knows best. But then, as far as he's concerned, that's a good thing, because God knows he don't.
Why, does he have complexes, too?
The family says he's sensitive. You know, they booted him out of Yale, Williams, Cornell, and someplace out in Ohio.
What for?
No idea.
Confound it! Don't you have any curiosity? Was it for women?
Him? If he went to a nudist camp, and they lined the men up on one side and the women on the other,
Ah, Donald.
Oh, Gus, you're here.
Yeah, well, I'm here.
I'm glad you got that settled.
Yeah, we wondered why it takes so long to pack Andy's things. Don't you think it'd be a good idea to get started?
Yes, I do, yes. I'm glad that you came, Mr. Pitcairn. Perhaps this could provide an opportunity for you and I to have a little chat. Of course, you're under no obligation.
I don't feel like chatting.
Ah, that was sensitive.
That's him to a T. Papa told him to come and chase you out. Did you hear him?
Yes. Yes. What about Papa Pitcairn?
I get the impression that he can tell a woman from a man.
With his eyes shut, a mile off. Mm.
You say that like you have proof.
He choked a girl once.
Choked her to death?
Oh, no. Just choked her. But enough to leave marks, because I seen him. Her name's Florence Heffron. See, Pitcairn was nuts about her. And he thought the baby that she was going to have wasn't his. Oh.
Was this talked about? I mean, was it published? Perhaps in a newspaper or reported in a court proceeding?
Well, how could it get in a court when he paid $40,000 to keep it out? But her folks used to live in a shack over on Greasy Hill. Now they got a nice house and 30 acres down in the valley.
Wolf was looking as pleased as if someone had just presented him with 30 acres of orchids.
What about Mrs. Pitcairn, his wife?
Oh, she's all right. Forget her.
Is she capable of carrying an object of 110 pounds into a greenhouse?
Oh, hell, she broke her back. Andy's been going up to her room every day for orders. Only she don't give orders. She discusses things.
Ah, she discusses things with Andy. Gus, I advise you never to get into the detecting business. Tell me, can you sketch a ground plan of this house, both floors?
Yeah.
Thank you, Gus.
Who the hell do you think you are?
If that was a rhetorical question, Lieutenant...
Damn it. I know who you are. You're some Broadway slicky who thinks you can come to Westchester and tell us the rules, huh? No. No, get going. Come on. Move out.
Come on, Chief.
Where's your chauffeur's hat, Goodwin?
Archie! Do not argue with him. Do not try to be witty. The man is an irresponsible maniac. Drive me straight to New York. Hope to see you soon, Gus.
You can buffalo him in New York, but not here. We'll be following you to the county line. Don't make any quick turns. Don't take any small roads. You hear me, Goodwin?
Archie, drive carefully, please.
They followed us to the Westchester County line as promised. I didn't care. Wolf's problem was that if he settled for getting home, Andy was cooked.
Are they gone?
Yeah.
How can we get off this race course?
Easy. That's what a steering wheel's for.
In about a mile.
That's so he instructed me to get Saul to meet us at the Covered Porch Restaurant in Scarsdale.
We'll meet Saul there. Give him a call. Tell him to come.
French would not believe that you were sound mind and body and not coming home for dinner.
Well, my purpose is to free Andrew Kosicki. And that is enough to keep me from going home, but I couldn't trust it to get me out again if ever I set back in.
Saul?
What happened?
What are you saying?
Did you look at this? You're going single file. I will be first. Saul will be second, Archie third.
What about guns?
What about guns?
I wanted ABC. When you're in the cell next to me and Andy, I don't want you booming at me that I bollocked it up because of the gun. So do I shoot, and if so, when?
No, there are too many eventualities. Just use your judgment, tempered by experience.
And what if somebody makes a dash for it?
Stop him.
And what if someone screams?
Stop her.
Sandwiches? Shall I take them?
I don't think we'll have time, Mr. Wolf.
Well? I have no rubbers. I have no rubbers!
Come on, we gotta go.
Had entangled my legs. Okay, I'm almost there. I'm all right. I'm all right. Did you see that? Did you witness that? So,
yeah, that was something, Mr. Wolf.
Okay,
it went for you.
After we climbed two mountains and pushed our way through a thicket, we were surprised by a brook. I leapt like a tiger. Saul jumped like a college athlete. Wolf chose not to test the laws of physics.
We're here for you. That's it. Almost there. Good job, Mr. Wolf.
There it is.
Don't you dare shoot!
This is a criminal act!
I don't think so. I had a key. Of course, Mr. Goodwin flourishing his gun complicates matters a bit, I must admit. But all I want is a talk with you people. May I sit down?
No!
I must overrule you. I have just waded your confounded brook. Hairier alternatives. Either I remain here and am allowed a free hand at investigating Miss Lauer's murder. Or I return to my office in New York.
Correction, you go to jail.
Well, if you insist, certainly. And then after I have paid my bail, I will devote myself to freeing Mr. Krasicki and finding the true culprit. At least three newspapers will help by making the inmates of this house objects of inquiry. Certain facts, which would never be put before a jury, will become the valid concern of the press.
Blackmail, hmm?
The devil of it is, Miss Pitcairn. We all have a past. Take this case. I'm sure they will want to know if the marks have completely disappeared from Florence Heffernan's throat.
You filthy fat louse!
Hey, not I, Miss Pitcairn. This is the inexorable miasma of murder. They will surely want to know why you have decided that you hate men. They will ask Donald if he left Yale, Williams, and Cornell because the curriculum didn't suit him. Or was it because the dean deemed him to be a violent, irrational lunatic?
Unfortunately, at this point, Donald's mood changed again.
Upstairs,
no.
Belle. I'm ordering you.
Oh, my God. How much have you hurt him?
He'll be sore a day or two. Shouldn't be too bad.
Mr. Wolf, I have money of my own. I'm willing to give you $50,000 if you will protect us from the sort of thing you just described.
I was liking this more and more. We now had our pick of going to jail or taking 50 grand.
How can I protect both Mr. Krasicki and you people when one of you was a murderer? No, I'm sorry. I did not go home for dinner. I fought my way through a snowstorm at night. No, I am going to remain here until I am allowed to investigate. Or, well, I told you the alternative.
I tried.
Sir, this is contemptible. But if you wish, inquire.
Thank you. Please bring in the embryos.
Once the embryos arrived, Wolf sent me to the greenhouse to wring out his socks. Not a very pleasant job.
Sal, you awake?
Yeah.
Well, then go.
As a diversion, he invited them all to the kitchen to show them where Mrs. Embry had kept her morphine. He acted as if he expected to tell from their faces which one had snitched it to dope Deanie Lauer.
It's completely ridiculous.
Let us begin. I fully expect you to lie. A fool could solve a case if everyone told the truth. Mr. Embry, did you ever hold Deanie Lauer in your arms?
Yes.
What?
You did. When?
Once, in this room. Because I thought she wanted me to. And she knew my wife was watching us. And I didn't.
That's a lie.
That's the spirit. We'll all confess to everything.
I can't believe that. You wanted to lead the way.
So there it was. The first crack out of the box, and he had one of them calling another a liar. I'm not saying it was dull, but it went on for over 2 hours. And at the end, we didn't know much more than at the beginning. But then we had a plan.
Archie, are my socks dry?
I'm going to bed. This is a farce.
It is a farce? It's not a farce because of me, sir. It's a farce because of you. My position is clear. I am your dangerous and implacable enemy.
Who's there?
Saul heard his cue and arrived.
Sit down! He's with us, and he doesn't bite. Sit down, I said.
Have you found anything significant, Saul?
Yes, sir. I think so.
Thank you. Archie, your gun.
Yeah, it's already out.
I was not satisfied with the thoroughness with which the police searched the house. So Mr. Saul Panzer, whose talents are exceptional, has been completing the job. And it proved me right. Where did you find this Saul?
Under Mr. and Mrs. Embry's mattress.
What is it?
It's a sheet of paper. The writing is ink, and I would judge the hand to be feminine. It is dated last night. It says, "Dear Mr. Pitcairn, I suppose now I will never call you Joe, as you wanted me to. As I told you, I think your gift to me should be $20,000. You have been so very sweet, but I have been sweet too, and I really think I deserve the $20,000. It is signed Dini. Of course, it can be authenticated.
I never saw it.
That's why you didn't let me marry her? You say I was no man? I was a man with her for the first time, and you wouldn't let me.
Then
she was moving away. Now I know why. And if I could kill her, I could kill you too. I can't.
No.
Give him to me.
Oh, my boy.
If Andy hadn't been leaving, he wouldn't have asked Deanie to marry him, and she wouldn't have run to torment Donald about it. His first and only romance, and she laughs at him. That right there was what put poor little Donald into a mood to murder.
Well, Mr. Archer. Yes, it's Nero Wolfe. As predicted, I have your murderer. We are at Pitcairn House. Come, and bring Mr. Andrew Krasicki with you from wherever you have him falsely imprisoned. I wish to take him home with me tonight.
Not so fast, Wolf. Let's have the letter. Where is it?
Here.
You can't burn that. That's evidence.
Why not? I wrote it.
Like hell you did. That was evidence. And by God, I'm going to see you in jail.
Phooey, no one saw it. No one saw it. Could have been a blank piece of paper I pretended to read from. Perhaps it was.
My son.
Mr. Krasicki is a woman's son, too, madam.
Oh, please.
Shh, Mommy.
I didn't think he had it in him.